Welcome to the parameter setting example video. This video demonstrates one approach described in the implementation brief for establishing parameters. In this video, I will model the types of questions and observations that educators should make when setting parameters using a normative approach, using three bands. This process is based on an educator's professional judgment. As a result, this example uses a fifth grade assessment because I taught fifth grade. The example assessment used for this video is a simplified assessment I developed to demonstrate the process. If I were to use a common measure in my own classroom, I would use a longer assessment or even consider assessment experiences that are not traditional stop and drop tests. So first, let's take a look at the assessment. We are going to use a straightforward pretest post-test example. Students would complete this assessment at the beginning of fifth grade and then would complete it again at the end of the year. It is 10 questions, and I would usually score each question as correct, partially correct, or incorrect. However, for simplicity, I will assume that each question is either correct or incorrect during this video. I also indicated which standard each question was intended to assess, so I could show my thinking, which I wouldn't include on a student assessment, since they could be distracting. You will also notice that this assessment balances different approaches to assessment based on the mathematical rigor triangle. As a result, we have balance of conceptual understanding, procedural fluency, and real-world application. As you can see, this first question is based on a third-grade standard. I would expect that almost all my students entering fifth grade would be able to answer this question correctly. However, I know that sometimes in a class of 25 students, I may have one student who may struggle even with this question. As a result, this question allows me to make sure that I pay close attention to this student during my teaching. In a similar vein, I expect that most students would answer question 2 correctly. However, I also know that there are some students that may make mistakes, whether it's forgetting to carry here or forgetting 8 times 7 here. As a result, this item tells me which students don't have full fluency over computation. While in practice, I wouldn't make instructional decisions based on only a few questions, this information may tell me which students could use additional practice, perhaps through different math games. Moving on to question 3 and 4, I get a sense of a student's mastery of other skills and concepts covered in fourth grade standards. Now, question 5 is ultimately assesses a fifth grade standard, but also builds upon multiple fourth grade standards. A student who is not able to answer this question correctly may not, because they don't remember what the term base means, or they may not be able to read this diagram correctly. Since 8 inches is on the top edge of the rectangular prism, and the diagram requires them to infer that the bottom edge is also 8 inches. Or they may not know how to compute volume. However, since this question is based largely on fourth grade standards, entering fifth grade, sometimes about half my students were able to answer this type of question correctly. However, some years most of my students may get this question correct, while in other years only a few students would answer it correctly. Looking over question 6, 7, and 8, I assess different fifth grade standards that most students will not have had previous experience solving. However, even with these questions, I may get a sense of a student's readiness. As an example, in question 7, assessing students' knowledge of fractions and the ability to add and subtract with unlike denominators, I would be able to see if a student was able to add fractions with like denominators. Finally, in the last two questions, we assess sixth grade standards. These questions represent an intentional decision about how to assess higher performing students. These questions assume that I am challenging higher performance students using acceleration, that is, the introduction to future standards. Questions 8 and 10 present tasks that require students to answer questions despite extraneous information. or imprecise information, which better assesses a student's ability to use these skills in a more authentic situations. For example, in question 10, the fact that cookies cost 50 cents is irrelevant. This is a different way to challenge higher performing students. Before we move on, I want to acknowledge that if I were to use a common assessment for my own fifth grade classroom, I'd want to ensure that I had a greater percentage of items that represented fifth grade standards. However, since I wanted a short assessment for this demonstration, I chose questions that ensured that I didn't have any major floor or ceiling effects. All assessments need to balance the information they get from the majority of respondents with the information they get on those on either end. And this is an important decision districts will make when deciding and selecting uncommon measures. After we familiarize ourselves with this assessment, the next step is to visualize three different students. I find this helpful way to move away from the conversation about points to one about student learning. So let's set up a table where I record the initial score ranges that will represent each of these three students. I will select one range of scores that are consistent with a hypothetical student who is struggling with fourth grade standards, one for a student who has mastered most fourth grade standards, and one that demonstrates mastery of more than fourth grade standards. So what range of scores are consistent with a student who is struggling with many fourth grade standards? Now, you may remember that questions 2, 3, and 4 assessed fourth grade standards. Now, since a student who has a reasonable command of fourth grade standards may still get one of these questions incorrectly, I have determined that a score of 3 is consistent with a student who understands most fourth grade standards. As a result, I've decided that scores ranging from 0 to 2 items correct best represents a student struggling with fourth grade standards. I could have made the decision to have scores of 0 to 1 or 0 to 3 represent this first student. However, initial score of 0 or 1 probably doesn't include enough students, and using 0 to 3 may represent too broad a range, making it more difficult to set a definition of moderate growth that is fair to all students. However, this is an area where reasonable educators may disagree and where I just have to make a decision. So I will record 0 to 2 in the first box. Next, what range of scores represent students who have mastered most fourth grade standards? Based on our previous decision, a score of 3 represents the lowest score that I think is still consistent with mastering fourth grade standards. On the other hand, if a student is able to answer the first 5 questions correctly, that tells me that this student has a strong command of the fourth grade standards, and even beginning to know some fifth grade standards. Once again, different educators may make a slightly different decision, but I will set the second band for students with scores ranging from 3 to 5. Now, it may seem that the final band should represent students who score from 6 to 10. However, students who scored 8 or more on this assessment are demonstrating that they already have mastery of most fifth grade standards and potentially even sixth grade standards. As a result, this assessment will not be able to give a good measure of their growth over the year. If many students fall into this category, I should consider revisions to the assessment itself to raise the ceiling. But today, I will set my top range for including scores of 6 to 7. And I will use other assessments to measure the growth of students with initial scores of 8 or higher without using this common assessment. Now that we have set bands, we need to consider what high, moderate, and low growth would be for each of these hypothetical students. So let's start with this first student. So this student answered 0, 1, or 2 items correctly. This student probably answered this first question correctly, demonstrating that they have some understanding of the base 10 number system, but are still struggling with many of the concepts that were covered in previous years. We may have learned from question 2 that they're struggling with fraction multiplication, and from question 3 that they don't have a deep understanding of fractions. So for this student, what scores are consistent with low, moderate, and high growth? One way to do this is to start thinking about low growth and to think about at what point you'd want to have a do-over. Or another way of saying this is, at what point would it make sense to make some changes to better support student learning? So concretely, if this student still had not begun to master at least some fifth grade standards by the end of the year, I would determine that this year did not work well for this student. A score of 5 is consistent with answering only one of the 4 questions that assess fifth grade standards correctly, while a score of 6, on the other hand, represents mastery of half of the fifth grade standards, which feels consistent with my goal of mastery of at least some fifth grade standards. As a result, I will set the range of low growth for a post-test score of 0 to 5. Now, it may be reasonable to argue that setting 6 correct answers as the lower limit of moderate growth for these initial scores may still not be rigorous enough. 6 correct answers may mean that the student still demonstrates mastery of only half of the fifth grade standards assessed. And of course, we want the student to master all fifth grade standards. However, if I consider that the student may have begun this year struggling even with third grade standards, like question 1, even a score of 6 would reflect over a year of growth for the student. As a result, I am comfortable that we have set the parameters we have set here provide meaningful feedback. However, this is a question that I want to revisit in the future. Now, on the other end of moderate growth, at what point was the year remarkable for this student? Considering that this student was struggling with multiple standards from previous years, it stands to reason if they were to demonstrate mastery of all fourth and fifth grade standards, this would be a clear demonstration of high growth. Since a score of 8 is consistent with mastery of all fifth grade standards on this assessment, we will define a score of 8 or higher as high growth. We can see that this is high growth when we take a closer look at the assessment. With an initial score of 2 and a post-test score of 8, the student probably didn't answer question 3 correctly on the pretest, meaning that they didn't have a good understanding of fractions at the beginning of the year. However, they probably got question 7 right on the post-test, meaning by the end of the year, they were able to add fractions with unlike denominators. As a result, this student would have moved from struggling to represent fractions to being confident in using them in operations. And that feels like high growth to me. So now that we've set the low and high parameters, I can complete the first line of the parameters because I've determined that moderate growth includes the scores 6 and 7. Next, let's consider the second student. This student correctly answered 3 to 5 questions at the beginning of the year. For the first student, we began by defining what we thought low growth would be, and then high, leaving moderate to be determined by those decisions. We could also start by defining moderate growth. So let's use that approach with the second student. Now, this student was able to answer questions representing fourth grade standards with some level of consistency. They could probably represent fractions from question 3 and could calculate area and even volume in question 5. To me, moderate growth would mean that they were able to demonstrate mastery of most fifth grade standards at the end of the year with a similar level of consistency. Now, on this assessment, a score of 8 represents a mastery of all fifth grade standards, while a score of 7 means that they missed only 1, which feels close enough. As a result, I will define moderate growth as a score from 7 to 8. Now, as a result, we've already defined low growth as 6 or lower, and high growth as a score of 9 or 10. Now, it's important to note here that since this assessment is only 10 questions, one single question has a dramatic impact on the determination of a student's growth. While this error is mitigated when we look across many different students, this is why in practice I would want an assessment with more points. Now let's look at the third student. Now, achieving a solid measure of growth for students with high initial scores can be challenging. For this third student with an initial score of 6 or 7, mastery of all fifth grade standards would be my expectation. As a result, a score of 8 is the lowest score that would still feel reasonable, like moderate growth. Anything less than this would be disappointing. As a result, I will determine the scores of 0 to 7 to be low growth. On the other hand, since this assessment has challenging questions from sixth grade standards, a perfect score is consistent with high growth for a student with only partial mastery of fifth grade standards at the beginning of the year. And I will leave 8 to 9 to be consistent with moderate growth. Now we have finished the table and have set parameters. You will notice that I set parameters in this example based on students' final score compared to their initial score. This is easier to do conceptually for many educators. Another approach is to set parameters based on change instead of final score. You can take a moment to compare the examples of parameters using either final score or change. While for many cases, this won't change the determination, for example, and a student with an initial score of 4 and a final score of 7 would have demonstrated moderate growth using both approaches. However, a student with an initial score of 5 and a final score of 7 would have demonstrated moderate growth using the first approach, but it would have been determined to have demonstrated low growth using change. Now, this is one of the many examples where districts are going to need to balance the relative costs and complexities of developing a more subtle scoring system. Remember, the goal is to provide a clear framework for having a meaningful conversation about student learning growth and achievement, and not to create an overly complicated scoring system that prevents meaningful conversation. Always use your professional judgment around which approach works best for your district. To that end, districts shouldn't get bogged down in long debates about the use of final score or change. Whatever approach a district chooses to use for the purposes of an educator's evaluation, a determination is not based on a single student or a single assessment, but a clear pattern across multiple students and over multiple years. Take a look at the parameters that I set during this activity. If you had a teacher where over half their students were demonstrating what I've called low growth, would you want this teacher to spend a little extra time reflecting on the practices they are using to support students? And similarly, if I had a teacher consistently demonstrating what I called high growth with over half their students, that is, even students walking in with a weak ability to demonstrate previous year's standards are demonstrating mastery of all fifth grade standards, is it not worth acknowledging the good work this educator is doing? It merits looking into the many decisions they make as an educator to see if there are excellent practices that could be shared with other educators from across the district. I conclude with a reminder that this example is just an example. Your professional judgment may set parameters in a different place, and that is okay. What is important is a transparent conversation about student learning growth and achievement so we can help all students succeed, whatever level they are starting at.